Today's topic is web cache, or the HTTP caching headers. As users, we get frustrated when the websites are slow, and to improve the performance, we normally use some kind of caching, which can either be on the server side in the form of application level caching, for example using Redis or Memcached, or it can be on the client side. So when the request comes for a resource, it will be checked in the cache. If it is not found in the cache, then the request will be sent to the server, the response will be fetched from there, and then it will be cached. And in the future, when the same resource is requested again, there will be no more calls to the server, the item will be found in the cache, and it will be returned from there. This brings us a couple of benefits. So first of all, we have the faster response times, because the requests are not going to the server, so our response times are going to be much lower. Secondly, because the items are returned from the cache and not the server, so our server bandwidth usage is going to decrease also. And the third one is the less load on the server, because not all the requests are going to the server, the load on the server is also going to decrease. Alright, so now that we know the benefits of the caching and what the caching is, let's look at the caching locations. So the cache can be in one of the three locations. First of all, we have the browser cache. So the browser you use might cache the response from any previous visits. It depends on the caching headers, which we will see in a minute, and the cache in the browser is private to the specific user using the website. Next, we have the proxy cache, which is the cache at the proxy level. I will make a detailed video on what the proxies and the reverse proxies are, but for now, just know that the proxies are installed either by your ISP or by the organization you work at, and the content might also be cached there. And the last one we have is the reverse proxy, which is the proxy that is closer to our server, is set up by the server administrators, and the content might also be cached there. Okay, now that we know what the caching is, what are the benefits of the caching, and the common places for the caching, let's look at some terminology before we jump on to discuss the caching headers and how the caching works. First of all, we have the client, which is your browser or any application requesting the server for some resources. Then we have the origin server, which is the source of truth, the place where we fetch the content from. And then on any location of the caching, we might have stale content, which is the content which is cached but it is expired. And then we have the fresh content, which is cached and it is still usable because it has not expired yet. And then we have some actions such as content validation, which is the process of contacting the server to check the validity of the cached content and to get it updated if it is expired. And lastly, we have the cache invalidation, which is the process of removing any stale content which is available in the cache. With that out of the way, let's understand how the content gets cached in any of the locations that we have discussed above. HTTP headers play the key role in caching the content at any of the places. Whenever the server sends the response to the client, it sends the HTTP headers in the response, which are then used by the client or any other intermediate places to cache the content. Let's look at the caching headers and see how they work. We have mainly expires, pragma, and the cache control. Expires and pragma were there before HTTP 1.1 and they aren't used as much, but you might see them being used for the backward compatibility. Cache control was introduced in the HTTP 1.1 and it is the preferred way of caching, and everything that you can do with expires and pragma, it's also possible with the cache control. We also have some validator headers, which are used by the client to make sure that the cached content is still usable. Let's look at each of these headers in detail. So first of all, we have the expires header. The value for expires header is the absolute expiry date till which the response can be cached. Some of the things that you should note about the expires headers are the value can't be more than 1 year, and if you provide the invalid value or return the wrong date format, the response will be considered stale. Next, we have the pragma header. The only possible value for that is no cache. It is one of the pre-HTTP 1.1 headers and it was used to prevent the caching. You should prefer to use the cache control over it, but you might still see it being used, and the reason for that is the backward compatibility. So that the clients that don't support cache control, they might be using this header to avoid the caching. And finally, in the caching headers, we have the cache control header. which is the preferred caching header, and it was introduced in HTTP 1.1. It's a multi-value header, so it can have multiple values or directives, and they determine the caching behavior. Let's look at the possible values for the cache control header. First of all, we have the private directive. If the cache is set to private, it means that the content is private to the user, and it will only be cached in the client or the browser. Next, we have the public directive, which means that the cache is available to multiple users, and it can be cached publicly at any of the proxies. Next, we have the no store, which means that the content can't be cached anywhere. So every time the client needs a resource, it must make the call to the server for the fresh copy. Next, we have the no cache value, which means that the content can be cached, but for client to reuse it, it must first validate it from the server. This is done using ETag header, for example, which we will see in a second. Then we have the max age, which tells the client that the content can be cached for the given number of seconds. So if you get a value like this, it would mean that the content can be cached at any public places or the proxies for 3600 seconds or 60 minutes. And having private would mean that the content can only be cached at the client and not any other place for 60 minutes. Next we have smax age. The prefix S stands for the shared. It is same as max age but gives the caching duration for the shared places or the proxies. And in the cases when you have both the max age and the smax age values present, it will take the max age value for the client side caching and smax age value for the shared caching. Next we have must revalidate. Sometimes it might happen that the server is not reachable or there is a network issue. In that case, the client might serve the cached content even if it is stale. If you have must revalidate in the value for the cache control, it won't allow using the stale content, and the content must be revalidated from the server before serving. If you look at the example value that I have here, if we don't have the must revalidate directive, client might keep serving the cached content even after it has expired, that is, after the max age of 600 seconds has passed and the server is not reachable for the fresh content. But if we have the must revalidate present, the client can only serve the cached content for 600 seconds, and after that it must fetch it from the server. And if the server is not reachable, it won't serve the cached content because it is stale. Next we have the proxy revalidate, which is same as must revalidate, but it applies to the proxies or the shared caching. So if the given header is present, it would mean that the client may keep serving the stale content available at the client if, let's say, it is not connected to the internet or it has network issues. But if it is able to connect to the proxy and there is a stale content at the proxy can't use the stale content and it must get it from the server. A note about mixing the values for the cache control. You can mix the cache control values however you want to achieve the caching behavior you require for your application. For example, the value that I'm showing here right now, it means that the cache is going to be public, so it can be stored at the proxies level as well as on the client. With the max age of 3600 seconds, we are setting the client level caching to be 1 hour, and with the smax age of 600 seconds, we are setting the proxy level caching to be 600 seconds. And also, since we have the must revalidate present, the client will never serve the stale content and it must fetch the fresh content from the server whenever it is expired. Up until now, we only discussed how the content is cached and how long the cached content is to be considered fresh, but we did not discuss how the client does the validation from the server. For that, server might send one or more validation headers in the response, which are used by the client to make a conditional request to the server. First of all, we have the ETags or the entity tags. When serving the content, server normally sends an ETag header in the response, which is just a unique identifier associated to the resource. Client then uses this ETag to make a request to the server to check if the content has been changed. Let's consider a scenario where the client requested an image and the server responded with the image and the following cache control and ETag headers. Now, the client will keep using the image from the cache for 3600 seconds or 1 hour. And after 1 hour, client will make the call to the server with the if none match header, and it will send the ETag of the resource in the call. The server will then match the ETag of the resource with the newly available resource. If it doesn't match, server will respond with the new ETag and the new resource, which will then be used to replace the current image. If it does match the existing image, the server will respond with the status code of 304, which means not modified, and the client will renew the cache for another 3600 seconds. Before we move on, there are two types of ETags, strong and the weak. First example is the strong ETag, and it means that the two resources are exactly same and there is no difference between them at all. Weak ETags are prefixed with the W, and they mean that the two resources are, although not strictly same, but could be considered same. Next we have last modified, which indicates the date and time when the content was last modified. When the content gets stale, client will make the conditional request with the last modified date using the if modified since header, which will then be used by the server to either return 304 not modified or to return the new response. Now you might be asking yourself, what if both the ETag and the last modified headers are present in the response? What header will then be used by the client to make the validation request to the server? Well, in that case, the client will send both the parameters in the validation request, the ETag in the if none match header and the modified date in the if modified since header. And the server checks both the values to either return 304 not modified or to return the new content. Okay, so what about the case when the server did not send any of these validation headers? Well, in that case, there will be no calls to validate and refresh the existing cache, and the fresh content will be requested as soon as the content gets stale. Alright, now that we know the caching headers and the validation, you might be asking yourself, what should be your caching strategy? And there is no global answer to that. It varies and depends on the nature of your application, but normally it might fall into two categories. Light caching for the items where you need the client to validate with the server. For example, your HTML files, where you can make the client cache it, but it must validate it with the server before using it. This way we are making sure that the client always gets the latest HTML whenever we have it available on the server. But if the HTML files have not been updated, it can avoid the download and serve the one that it has cached in the browser. For the dynamic content, it depends on your needs. So for example, if you have RSS feed for your blog, you might cache it publicly for 2 hours. But if you have product listing, let's say JSON for an e-commerce website, you might have a different kind of caching headers in the response. For the assets, you can have aggressive caching. So for example, here I am caching my CSS, JavaScript and the images for an year in the public caches. And I might use the fingerprinted file names. So for example, my build system will generate a different file name for each build and inject them into my HTML. So whenever the client will request the HTML, it will see that the links have been changed, so it will load the new assets from the original server instead of serving them from the cache. And lastly, to debug the HTTP headers, you can either do it with the curl command with the option I, which will give you the headers from the response, or you can do it from the dev tools in the network tab.
I hope you enjoyed the video. If you have any questions or comments, leave them below, and I will see you in the next one.